So here is a progression over time of the order of treatment that you could consider, because ADHD is more than ADHD. It can be alcohol, stimulant, and substance abuse. Now, it's very hard to treat ADHD while this is going on. So it's a really good idea to try to get this under control early in treatment, maybe even before, because in some cases you have to give a stimulant, which is being abusing. And then, oh my God, that's really amazing. But the funny thing is that if you actually treat people with ADHD and stimulants, they abuse less than if you don't treat them with stimulants, because then they seek them out and self-medicate and do a pretty poor job of it. The other thing is, it can be very difficult to treat ADHD in the middle of a mood episode, if they're manic particularly, but also if depressed and having anxiety disorders. Now, what's very interesting in terms of adult psychiatrists versus child psychiatrists is that even if a person has ADHD, if they come with alcohol or substance abuse, mood disorder or anxiety disorder or some mixture, we are very preoccupied with treating them. And often, it really is true, we may not even recognize ADHD or get to treating it, which would be next on the list. The funny thing about treating children is that there is so much preoccupation with treating ADHD that sometimes that's all you do, and you don't look for the comorbidities, including things like nicotine dependence, which occurs, you know, even in childhood, let alone adulthood. Self-medication, because nicotine is a stimulant. So treatment in adults often ends after you do the comorbidities before you even get to ADHD, whereas treatment in children and adolescents often begins and ends with just treating ADHD. So we should be mindful that these patients have more than maybe meets the eye, or more that's on the surface, because inattentiveness can be a part of many adult disorders, and we need to look to make sure whether there's any treatment of ADHD as well. We think that there's an importance in the functional activity of norepinephrine and dopamine in the prefrontal cortex. So in the lecture that I gave you on the pathophysiology of ADHD, we talked about that pyramidal neuron that's in blue there in the PFC, prefrontal cortex, and it's out of tune. And often there's too much noise, which would be fidgeting for hyperactivity, shifting attention for inattentiveness, and as opposed to sitting in your seat and focusing, which would be the opposite of that. So the noise predominates, and you can't tell the signal from the noise, and the brain goes to the noise. So you don't sit in your seat and you don't focus. That's called ADHD. And on the right, it looks like maybe norepinephrine's too low and dopamine's too low, which means you have bad signals and too much noise. How are we going to fix that? Well, the idea would be to enhance both norepinephrine and dopamine. And that's the treatment that is really the hallmark of almost all treatments of ADHD. Many, many, many patients get that kind of a treatment. So what you want to do is move those arrows up, and that's best done with a stimulant of one kind or another if you want to move both of them up about the same. And then if you're lucky, and believe me, these medicines can work almost from the first dosing, you can change noise into noise and signals into enhanced signals, so you stop fidgeting and stop shifting your attention, and you start sitting still and focusing. Theoretically, because you've enhanced norepinephrine and dopamine. Theoretically, because you've reduced noise and enhanced signal. Chronic stress can give you the opposite situation, where, particularly in adults, you have so much stress that your norepinephrine and dopamine go up, and you're just as out of tune, so you actually still have too much noise and not enough signals, and you're fidgeting, and in adults, we would say, having problems more with attention. And so the idea is that you want to actually bring those down. So if you're treating at this stage, you want to lower them, but often what happens is that the patients don't get treated, and they go on and on and on, and they're slowly depleting their stores of dopamine and norepinephrine, and they end up low as well. And then the stress just continues. And so they have a problem with noise being too high and signals being too low throughout the course of chronic stress. And so what we want to do in chronic stress and ADHD is often do the same thing we do in regular ADHD, which is increase norepinephrine and increase dopamine. And that can be done with stimulants. And you get better signals and you reduce the noise.